Morning, everybody. Just testing, testing. Morning, everybody. Welcome. Good to see you all. Good morning, everyone. All good, Alan? Okay. morning, everyone. So good to see you all. Good morning, everyone. Last weekend, I was in Stornoway on the Isle of Lewis, spending a long weekend with church there, and what a wonderful time I had, let me tell you. But it is good to be back amongst my ain folk, and that's you. It is good to be here with you today. Three notices, very quickly, make that four. This afternoon, Messy Church. This evening, an evening worship celebration when we're going to ask the question, what is God like? What is God like? With the band leading lots of great uplifting praise. That's tonight at 7 o'clock. Outside in our gallery, we have our fair trade stall today. This is usually recognized as Fair Trade Fortnight, and folks will be at the stall after service. If you want to go and see, find things there, that would be wonderful. And then all the way through to next Friday evening, we have a congregational gathering when we'll be reminiscing and giving thanks and spending time together. Most of all, spending time together. We very much look forward to it. I do believe, Linda, it's sort of fully booked, which is nice but problematic if you are not in for it so far. It starts at 7:30 and you can arrive from 7 o'clock onwards, and we've got a great night in store. We look forward to it, and that will take us all the way back to next Sunday morning when we will share communion, whole church together, and much to be thankful for on that day. But for now, we're here to worship, yes? So let's stand and we'll sing together before the throne of God above. Let's stand together and sing. Christ, my Savior and my God. A Savior is one who saves. I want to share a fantastic good news story this morning with Elise. And it's a story of someone being saved, literally. So Elise, can you come on up to the lectern, please? So a whole number of years ago, what, 10 or 11 years ago or something like that, you felt moved, motivated to do what?
Good morning. So 10 years ago, I signed up to the Anthony Nolan Register. I heard about it through my Auntie Jane, and it's basically to help people with like sort of blood cancer and things like that.
And what did that actually involve for you?
So basically, I just filled in a little survey and then ended up getting a spit test through the post, did that, sent it back, and then that was all I had to do really until I got the call.
That was all you had to do apart from actually doing it, which was down to London. You were there. Tell us a little bit about what that experience was like, giving your plasma and so on.
So when I joined the register in summer of 2013, I got the phone call in November 2013 to say that I was a potential match. So that entailed of going to get some blood tests, and they get sent away, and then they then do the tissue typing and then find out if I was the match that they were looking for, which, hurrah, I was. So I went to, like, found out 2 days before Christmas that I was the match they were looking for, and then went down to London for basically what's an MOT, make sure I'm healthy, and then I could donate, which then happened in the February of 2014.
And how long was that? How sore was it, the actual process of donating?
Wasn't sore at all. You're just a human pincushion, so it was just, you know, a lot of blood taken, and then, you know, x-rays, that kind of thing, but nothing too serious. But on the day of donation, you get hooked up to a machine for 4 hours, which is quite nice. You just sit back, relax, take a load off, and they basically just pull your blood out of one cannula, sift it through a machine, take what they need, and put your blood back in.
Okay, so all sounds so straightforward, the way you say it, as if it was like no big deal, but I think anybody who can even get an idea of what it is would know it is a big deal. Now, at the time, correct me if I'm wrong, you had no idea who might get those blood products from you?
No, I had no idea who it was. You can be on the register forever and never get used. When I went down for the day of testing, there was a lady that had been on the register for 20 plus years and then got the phone call that she was needed. I got 5 months, and that's when I was needed for, well, Steph. So she has a name.
Okay, so you texted us about a week ago and you said that you'd had some really great news. So share that with us now. Bear in mind we're virtually 10 years further on.
Yeah, so 3 days before the 9-year anniversary of the stem cell donation and transplant, I got an email through Anthony Nolan saying that the donor wanted to make contact. So I was like, absolutely. So sent my information away. Within 24 hours, I was chatting to her, which is bizarre. Like sending some emails, we're now friends on Facebook. So if you've seen a massive number 9 on my Facebook post, that's because it's been 9 years since transplant and she's well and alive.
And can you give us her first name?
Steph.
Seth.
Steph.
Steph. Yep. And she's alive and well, thanks to basically your donation.
Yeah. I mean, for what I did was absolutely nothing in comparison. She just needed a helping hand. If that was what my cells did, then I'd do it again. I mean, I have done it again. I have done it to a second recipient. So there is some of my DNA somewhere to two people. So
at least the thing is, you're making it such a not a big deal. Well, it wasn't this. It was, you know, it was nothing really. But it was, because there is a woman, Steph, today, who is alive and well, who otherwise would not have been, thanks to what you did. And so, don't you love that spirit of generosity when you realise that you can do something for someone else and make a great difference? And of course, now you have your own.
Yep.
Who is playing with Gran right now? And some kind of peekaboo, hide-and-seek game, and so on. But, you know, I just thought that's worth sharing, isn't it? Because many of you will remember when Elise went down to London to donate blood products, and now someone lives because of that. So let's give a massive cheer to Elise. God is good in all kinds of ways, and as I said, Elise, we have celebrated with the family, with Elise and Matt, in the birth of Una and her baptism just a few weeks ago. So somebody was literally saved. Life was saved by that donation. And when we gather, Christians one with another, we celebrate Sunday by Sunday that he is our Savior, that Jesus Christ came into the world as our Savior to save us and to give us life and life in all its fullness. And isn't it interesting, the more you think about it, Elise gave some of her blood, and Jesus gave all of his blood that we might live. So, folks, we have so much to be thankful for. Let's bow our heads, and together shall we pray. Lord, what a wonderful story of life-giving generosity. We thank you for Elise's willingness, readiness to do what she did. And now that Steph is alive and well, living life because of Elise. And for all of us, we have life because Jesus gave himself. Not just a donation, not just a little bit, but all of himself for us. We thank you for him, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I think the band's coming forward again. And we're going to sing a simple little song that we introduced a few weeks back, maybe a few months back, actually. Jesus, Strong and Kind. And I guess it's the kind of song you might relate to with children, but the truths contained are for all of us. So let's stand together. We're going to sing Jesus, Strong and Kind.
No one else can satisfy me.
you know, it's almost certain that in a number of people of this magnitude that there will be someone here today or some people who here today who are, we might say, thirsting, not necessarily for a drink, but inwardly longing for God and how God satisfies us. And no doubt there are some people here today who are feeling weak, whether physically done like that or inwardly just all about done. And maybe there are some here today who are fearing where you are and what might be around the corner in your life or of those loved ones who are near to you. And I guess there will be some here today who feel in one way or another lost. Lost in your own self, lost in any sense of connection with other people, and maybe even lost from the God who you sensed you once knew well. We have the promise that in all of those circumstances and more, the Lord is good and faithful. He will keep us day and night, and we can always run to Jesus because He is strong and kind. Friends, have that truth cemented in here, even for those tough times in life. Okay, so the bouncy castle is up in the hall. There will be, have to prove your age as you leave the church. And boys and girls, there you go. So like Una is really up for it and good to go. I think Cameron and Orla are probably up for it and good to go. Karen and Carla are heading through there now to get the castle in place. Rory is probably going. There's Lisa Marie going and any others. I saw Poppy earlier. She's probably on her way already. And there goes Leah as well. Bouncy castle time and much fun in store. Hands up if you think you've got a good memory. I mean, somebody, surely. I think we all reckon that maybe as well as the years go on, we've become more forgetful. Well, maybe not. About 5 years ago, the minister, Tom Gordon, came from Edinburgh as a guest of our church one Sunday morning. Tom writes modern-day parables and short stories in which he encapsulates great spiritual truths. He writes also poetry and songs and hymns, many of which are wonderful. Maybe some of you will remember that day when Tom came. But I, for one, had completely forgotten that Tom wrote a hymn especially for St. Andrew's Church that day. I'd forgotten, but not Anne Fife. Now, you know, sometimes you say, well, as you get older, you become more forgetful. Well, not in Anne's case, because Anne, just stand for a wee moment, please, just in case we're not sure. So Anne remembered, and two Sundays ago, she came to me and said, can we sing the song, the hymn that Tom Gordon wrote for St. Andrew's Church? Honestly, I could not remember that he'd written a hymn at all. But sure enough, I phoned him. Anne had a copy of it still in her house. I phoned Tom, we got it from him, and it's here. And we're going to sing it today, so Anne, thank you so much for reminding us of that. And if you ever forget anything, check with Anne. She probably knows. If you look at the windows at the back of our sanctuary space, one after another, we have etchings which encapsulate what we've always tried to be about as a church, welcome. Welcome means that everyone and anyone who sets foot through these doors is genuinely part of family. The middle window says worship because worship is the first calling of God's people to glorify Him. And the third W is, of course, witness. We don't just come to church, we go out from church to witness to God's love that we have experienced for ourselves. And so the hymn has these three verses and then one to finish. The only thing is, you knew there was some kind of catch. The tune is not one that we can easily translate to the band. So we have a backing track of the hymn. But it gets more complicated still. Because the hymn is four verses. The backing track's only got two. So we're going to sing the first two verses. And then somewhere up there, someone will be frantically putting the track back to the beginning. But the problem is that you'll get the introduction again. Are you following? Yes. It will work, honestly. It will work. And Anne is right. The words are wonderful. They speak of who we seek to be as a church, as we look back and as we go forward. So the words will come on the screen. Rachel, let's see, the very first line declares this. God's love declares to all who are far and near, you are welcome here. That's for every single one in here today and watching online. So you've got it. Two verses, a little pause, not enough to get a cup of tea, just a little pause. Introduction, we go again with verses 3 and 4. It will work. Trust me, let's stand.
Thank you.
say thanks to Anne for remembering that we even had that hymn at all. Thank you, Anne. Thank you. And they are wonderful words, and it's our hymn for this church. And thank you, Anne, for remembering. So a few weeks back, as we launched out into this mini journey through the letter of James, I told you on that Sunday that it was special to me because it really was the first part of the Bible when I was younger that really spoke and that made me think that is what gets me going. And it was his sense on the thoroughly practical and the need for faith always to be translated into something that you could see and touch, into something that was thoroughly practical. James's letter is concerned with the day-to-day of everyday life. Now, when we come to the final chapter, then we get something of an onslaught, a full frontal attack on the rich. But as we read into it, we find, well, it's not so much the rich for being rich, but when that becomes something more, and when it becomes, shall we say, the exploitation of those who have much less. Listen to some of these words that James pens in the last chapter. "And now, you rich people, listen to me." Bear in mind that in terms of the world's population, we all are rich. "Weep and wail over the miseries that are coming your way. Your riches have rotted away. Your clothes have been eaten by moths. Your gold and silver are covered with rust. And this rust will be a witness against you and will eat up your flesh like fire. You have piled up riches in these last days. You have not paid any wages to those who work in your fields. Listen to their complaints. The cries of those who gather in your crops have reached the ears of God, the Lord Almighty. Your life here on earth has been full of luxury and pleasure. You've made yourselves fat for the day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered innocent people, and they do not resist you." Wow, strong language indeed. But really the gist of it is this business of piling up wealth for ourselves, I suppose in the sense that that is where our trust is put rather than in God. And then in the exploitation that he describes, where workers are not paid their dues and so on. Anytime I read a passage like this, certainly with James, I think to myself, what would he say now? What would James as a prophet say now as he surveyed the scene in our country and around the world? What would he say, for example, that there are many in this nation who are struggling to manage, and I know folk personally, to pay gas bills and electricity bills and so on, while the great oil and gas corporations of the world have tripled their profits in this last year? I've got a strong sense of what James would say, and it wouldn't be complimentary. It's why Christians should always be involved with, concerned with the world and what goes on in the world. James was, it's here in Scripture, we are called to it. And yet, in Scotland today, maybe more widely, but certainly in Scotland, notice what happens when Christians seek to be involved. MD up to speed with Kate Forbes, member of the Free Church of Scotland, a sincere and genuine and committed Christian woman, a very, very able person. I've heard no one within nationalist circles say anything but that she is the most talented politician of her generation. Young for sure, but then look to countries like New Zealand and Finland, who have been led by women in their 30s and have benefited from it. But here in Scotland, apparently not, because she has strong, let me call them, traditional Christian values. And there are many who say that rules her out from any possibility of being our First Minister. You see, what folks are saying is this, a version of this. We don't mind you Christians having your beliefs, but keep them to yourselves. We don't want your faith influencing. This is an interesting crossroads in the life of our country. It really is. It's a little moment in time, I think, how Kate Forbes has been spoken to and treated. And if you're on Twitter, I mean, you want to see it on there. It is incredible. The onslaught, the vitriolic onslaught coming her way. Now, I say this. Give me politicians who are courageous enough to say what they believe. I'll take that any day rather than those who decide what they believe depending on where the votes are going to come from. So she has conviction, but apparently conviction is not welcome. Wow, where is our nation going? How much further down the secularist road can we go? A nation that altogether abandons its roots in faith is a nation in trouble. We watch with interest, but believe me, what's happening right now is a sign of the times. And Jesus said to his followers, watch and read the signs of the times. Now, just to be 100% clear, in case we have anybody takes this the wrong way, this is not party political. I'd be saying exactly the same thing regardless of the party involved. It's the Christian element to it that matters here. Glad to get that off my chest. And yet, of course, James covers all the bases. And if you go towards the end of the fifth chapter, then you get him encouraging prayer for one another within the house of God, within the family. Are any of you in trouble? You should pray. Are any of you happy? You should sing praises. Are any of you ill? You should send for the church elders who will pray over you in the name of the Lord. You see, James was thoroughly practical, a hands-on, practical approach to faith. But don't let yourselves be fooled into thinking that somehow he wasn't interested in the more spiritual aspects of the faith. Far from it. He encourages a prayerful desire, a prayerful commitment within the fellowship of the church. Let me read for you. Where's my phone? I screenshotted this. Way back in the 19th century, the most famous preacher in the whole of Britain was Spurgeon, Charles Spurgeon. He preached in London at the age of 22 years of age. People were coming the length and breadth of the nation to hear Charles Spurgeon speak. Listen to this. On one occasion, five young students were spending a Sunday in London, so they went to hear the famed Charles Spurgeon preach. While waiting for the doors to open, the students were greeted by a man who asked, "Gentlemen, let me show you around. Would you like to see the heating plant of the church?" They were not particularly interested, for it was a hot day in July. But they didn't want to offend the stranger, so they consented. The young men were taken down a stairway, a door was quietly opened, and their guide whispered, "Here is our heating plant." Surprised, the students saw 700 people bowed in prayer, seeking the face of God for blessing on the service that was soon to happen. Softly closing the door, the gentleman then introduced himself. It was none other than Spurgeon himself. Take out prayer. And where are we? People, we need to be a family of prayer. Now, maybe honestly, see, moving house, it completely throws your equilibrium. Maybe there are some who think, well, I hear you. I really would like to pray more faithfully, but where do I start? I really don't know where, why, how I should pray. I have 10 little booklets today called Living on a Prayer. These are absolutely excellent. And if there's someone who thinks, yeah, okay, I would like to be part of the prayer of a church family, the prayer of my Christian life, come and take one of those books. And really, there should be none left at the end. And so much for James, but I want to talk a little bit in the remainder this morning about a passage from Paul to the Philippians. Paul's wonderful letter to the Philippians. I was reading it for my own devotional interest just recently, and in the first chapter, there seemed to me to be verse after verse which spoke to my situation right now. It seemed to me so relevant. Now, that can be true of any of us at any time. We open the pages of Scripture and somehow it speaks to us. Somehow it deals with where we are at. And so it seemed to me. So you get this from the letter to Paul to the Philippians at the beginning. Verse 3, "I thank my God every time I remember you." Now, Paul was now removed from them, in prison, no longer able to be with them, and so on. But here he was in his mind, writing to them and saying to them, "I thank my God every time I remember you." And I guess this is what seemed so real to me right now. I do thank God for you. I will continue to thank God for you in the days to come, remembering you and thanking God for you. Thanking God, for example, for those who have served here. I think, for example, of the session clerks through the years, Bill and Audrey and Jane and Joan. I think of the Beadles, the church officers, Mr. Gray, MD long enough in the tooth to remember Mr. Gray, one or two hands up. And then Phil Corns, and then Ron Tasker, of course, and Janice, the irreplaceable Janice. I think of those who have stewarded our finances, Derek, of course, and Susan, and Scott, and I am thankful for that service. I think of those who stewarded our buildings. George, Alan, Jim, Bobby, Ian, Ray, Ken, even now. I think of those who have led us in worship through the years here at the front and have done so with such commitment and dedication. And as I remember, I thank God for all of those different folks. And in terms of what I was saying just a moment or two ago, there have always been faithful prayers in the life of the congregation. And boy, am I thankful for them. We have folks who are no longer able to come to church on a Sunday, and yet when I speak with them from time to time, they say this to me, Martin, we pray for you every single day. I think of those with thankfulness who have led us in outreach beyond the doors of the church, whether locally, in the various serving projects that we have had across this community, and more widely into the world, where the need is. There are those here who have sought to take us to where that need is, in the name of Christ. As I think of those who have led us, I think of those who have fed us. And not least in that kind of way, and some are sat right over there at the front right now. How many lovely meals have we enjoyed in this place through the years? Breakfasts, lunches, dinners, teas, high teas, all sorts of things. And as I think on all of that, I thank God for that service. I thank God as I remember those who have nurtured our children and young people through Sunday school then and now, through our Bible classes and youth groups, and of course the result of that nurture. Here and in other churches across Scotland who were nurtured by some of you in this place. I thank God for those who have cared for us, offering loving pastoral care when need has arisen. And I thank God for those who have made my life somewhat organized, from Alison way back to Linda right now. And what a difference it has made in our church having able administrators keeping the show on the road, brilliantly, of course. But alongside those various kinds of categories of people, most of all, as Paul did regarding the Philippians, I thank God when I remember all of the ordinary, faithful folk who have made up the family of St. Andrew's Church, who were now gone from us, who are and who will be in the days to come. And I know that if I pause even for a moment and allow my imagination to begin to play, I see face after face of faithful folk, each one remembered and loved, and somehow as part of a cloud of witnesses still with us. Paul goes on, he writes, your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now is what he gives thanks for, and so do I. Your thankfulness in your partnership in the gospel. And my hope and prayer as we go forward, and my confident hope and prayer is encapsulated in what Paul writes near the end of that first chunk of chapter 1. Here it comes. That he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion. The good work was cemented on the cross at Calvary as Jesus gave his blood for our salvation, that we might live life and live it in all its fullness. The work of salvation started there. And my prayer is that God himself, through his Holy Spirit, will continue that work in your lives in all the days to come, that he will draw you closer and closer to himself, will build you up in faith. Everybody remember Magnus Magnusson? What was his catchphrase? I've started, so I'll finish. And so the Lord has started a work in your lives. And my prayer is that he will carry that to completion in all of your lives. What Paul writes, I echo. He says, it is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. So says Paul from a prison to the Philippians. I have you in my heart. And then the final part of that chunk of the chapter says this. I told you I'm just swimming in paper this morning, and none of it seemingly in the right order. Paul, and this is my prayer. It's now my prayer. That your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best, and that you may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Well, if Paul was able to pray that for those he had ministered among, then why might I not pray it too for all of you, faithful folk, that God would complete that work he started, that he would carry it to completion, and that in all things you would come to know him. And as you do now, more so in all the days to come, for he will hold you fast. He is Lord, he's Savior, he's Teacher, he's Friend, he is Shepherd. He is everything. So allow him to throw his loving arms around you and in his embrace to hold you fast. Now and always. Amen. And may God bless to us these reflections on the words of both James and Paul. In all of it, in the journey we make in faith, we come to know this above all, that God is good. And so the band's going to come forward now and lead us together as we sing the goodness of God. The goodness of God. And so we'll stand together and affirm this great truth that God always has been, is now, and always will be good. So, while entrusting you into the arms of God, also when a minister is ready to move on, he or she entrust you into the hands of another shepherd. And so Jonathan, as you know, will be here as our locum minister and will be your teacher and preacher and shepherd in this next period of time. And Jonathan's going to lead us in prayer now. And Jonathan, come on forward, please, and if you would do that, thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. It's really good to be with you this morning. Oh, some sermon. God has just blown me away with that. And it's good to be blown away sometimes by the goodness of God, isn't it? It's good. The one phrase that God has been placing on my heart is to share with you that he is in the transitions. We're all in a time of transition, and he's in it. We're not just to think about the outcomes or what's to happen next and somehow that God is going to be there, but actually God is in everything, and that's what we were singing about just now. All my life you have been faithful. So let's bring our prayers before the throne of God. Heavenly Father, I thank you that through Jesus Christ and through the power of the Holy Spirit amongst us, that you are here in every turn and facet of life. That you are with us through all transitions, through all the times and all the places that we go. I thank you that we have a God that never lets us go. You hung on that cross, Lord Jesus, until it was finished. You didn't leave that assignment until everything was completed and you had won salvation for us by your blood. Lord, I want to praise you and thank you for the ministry of Martin and for Elaine, for the whole family who have been so much part of this congregation here and this church family. And Lord, I pray for your blessing upon them both and their boys as they move into the new commissioning that you have for them. Lord, be in that transition of laying down and of all the reminiscing and the sadnesses that would come as part of that, but also be alongside them as they enter that new time of adventure and joy and possibility. Lord, help them to know your mighty presence with them, Lord, sustaining them, strengthening them, granting wisdom and guidance along the way. And Lord, as we release Martin and Elaine to the next chapter of their lives, God, we welcome your presence and your guidance in the next chapter of the life of St. Andrews. Lord, would you be with us through the times of emotion, remembering the good times, remembering the struggles, remembering all that's happened over the years, but to see you and your faithfulness through all of those times, and to remember that you are faithful to the end of time, and that you will be in the next phase of what happens here. Lord, I pray for the leadership team here specifically. I pray for office bearers, and that you would, that a great mantle of wisdom would come from heaven for this period of time. And also for Kate and myself coming, Lord, that there would be a real interconnection between us and the leadership here, and that there would be great connectedness here in the congregation, Lord, that as we travel this next road together, that you would lead and that you would nurture us all, Lord, that this community here would be that community of welcome, that community of worship, and that community of witness, all for the glory of your name, Lord Jesus, that many souls would come to know you and be saved. Lord, we rejoice in what Martin said, that you are the God who always finishes what he starts. That work on the cross continues. But Lord, as we pray that you will be in the transitions here for us, this church family here in St. Andrews, that you would also be in the transition for the church in Arbroath. I mean, we have a transition team that are working now on how things will look in the future when all the congregations come together. Choppy waters, but yet you are the one who walks upon those waters, Lord Jesus, and brings your peace and calm. And we pray that that direction would be imparted to the transition team to lead the churches, Lord, in the way ahead and what's to come. Lord, we're also in transition time in our political setup. Martin alluded to that, of this turmoil that's going on now in relation to the selection of a new first minister. Lord, we pray that this land would be a place where individuals have a right to freely state their beliefs and to freely be themselves and to pursue that which is on their hearts, and yet that there should also be that unanimity and that unity that comes from collective responsibility for our democracy to function well. So, Lord, we pray for that tolerance and we pray for that collective unity, that you would put the right person in place as our first minister for this next time ahead, Lord, and that your presence and your peace would be upon that process. As Martin said, we're alluded to Jesus' teaching on the signs of the times. So we bring to you, Lord, our wider situation in the world, where we are seeing the signs of the times, these last days, when there is so much destruction, there's so much war and rumors of war, there are famines. We don't need to watch very long on our televisions or listen very long on our radios before we can see that we're in these last days. And yet you are faithful through those times, Lord. Help us not to see a world in its death throes, but a world in the pain of new birth, birth pains of the new kingdom of God coming. Let your kingdom come, Lord Jesus, on this earth, that we might see a turning around of some of these intractable and difficult problems, that we might see the refugee and migrant crisis addressed, Lord, homes for those that need them, jobs and security, that we might see relief for those places where there's been earthquakes and other signs of the difficulties in our earth. Lord, that your hand would be upon all of this. So, Lord, as we bring these prayers to you, we take just a moment to reflect and to seek your face, Lord Jesus, in whatever way we need right now as we enter this next time of transition. Would you come, Lord, and minister to us by your Holy Spirit? Just take a moment to allow that to happen. As you calm our fears and you steady our feet as we walk forward with you. So, Lord, thank you that you are gathering up these prayers and that you are petitioning the Father on our behest. Thank you, Lord Jesus, as we pray these things in your mighty and glorious name. Amen.
Thank you, Jonathan, for leading us in that part of our worship. Folks, I think you know even already that in Jonathan you will have both strong and sensitive leadership, and we are thankful to God that the circumstances have made this possible. A wee note, folks, and this again will be a name that will be remembered to some of you who were here in much earlier days, Ken Meekison. As I say, some of you remember that name, Ken Meekison, who was very much central to this church in former days. He died, we only learned it this week, on the 17th of December in Croydon down south. I still loved getting our Quest magazine. I think he's lived down south for certainly before I came here, and yet I know some of you will remember the name Ken Meekison. For Ken's life, for his faith, for his witness, we give thanks to God. Friends, that God will be faithful, that God is good, we know that for sure. But what about us? And so as an invitation now to sing our final praise, which is this opening line, O Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Is that your promise? Will you remake that promise this morning? Or for the first time, saying, O Jesus, I have promised, I am promising to serve thee to the end. Stand together and we will sing.
Yeah.
praise and worship on the goodness of God. Wednesday morning with communion, 10:30 service, and next Sunday, 11 o'clock for a family celebration together. But for now, go in peace. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you and those you love today and forevermore. Seated, thank you. May the Lord give you peace indeed. These are those little prayer booklets. They're right here. 49 pence each, no great expenditure, but take them nonetheless. Elders, as you know, to gather at the front afterwards and thereafter, folks. Fair trade stall I mentioned, and all those other things happening during the week. Go in peace. Thank you and bless you.